Thank you. Welcome to St. Luke's on this fourth Sunday of Easter. So glad that you're here gathered in worship. We will begin worship with the responsive reading for our thanksgiving for baptism. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Just as God's work of creation never ends, so the gifts received in baptism are renewed every day. For waters to play in and waters to inspire wonder. For water that gives life to our planet.
We give you thanks, O God, for the waters of life.
We give you thanks, O God, for the waters of this place. For water from our tap, for rain and snow, for our local water sources from Nine Mile Creek to the Mississippi River. We give you thanks for your salvation through water, for delivering Noah and his family through the flood waters, for leading your people Israel through the sea into freedom, for preserving your prophet Elijah through the time of drought, for guiding your people across the Jordan into a new land, for quenching the Samaritan woman's thirst with living water.
We give you thanks for your salvation through water.
We give you thanks for the life of all the baptized, for all who gather here, for godparents and baptismal sponsors, for children and grandchildren, for brothers and sisters in Christ, whom we have never seen, but to whom we are bound.
We give you thanks for the life of all the baptized.
We give you thanks for the life in Christ through your Holy Spirit, for our entry into Jesus' death through these waters, for our new birth into a life of freedom and service, for our calling to be your people sent out for the life of the world.
We give you thanks, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen.
Again, welcome to St. Luke's. So glad that you're here gathered in worship. Just a few announcements to share with you at this time. Although we cannot gather in person, we are gathering often online, and there are a number of opportunities for you to participate. Know that we have daily devotions shared each day on our Facebook. On Wednesdays, we have a family worship at 4 p.m., and then we have an adult study available at both 1 p.m. and 6 p.m. on Zoom, and the youth group gathers on Zoom at 7 p.m. All the information can be found on our church website, or you can call the office. A couple other fun notes. The Rain Garden is beginning this week. If you drive by, you will see the construction for that. And much thanks for the cards, the letters, for those who stop in and share their offering and drop off a gift for Veep. At this time, it is so important for us to share the gifts that God has given us that we can share with others in His name. Again, thank you for joining us in worship.
Your The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Messiah, Jesus, your followers established churches in communities near and far. Take us outside of ourselves and teach us to give away what you have given to us. Show us how to witness to your presence in places near and far.
Amen.
Hi kids, come close. I've got a message just for you. Do you remember a few weeks ago I showed you all of the beautiful little plants that were growing in my kitchen window? And we were talking about how seeds go into the ground and you think that there's nothing there, but then something beautiful grows up and there's new life. Well, I want to talk to you again about seeds. Sign language for seeds goes like that. A seed you can plant inside yourself. Have you ever heard somebody tell you, if you swallow watermelon seeds, you'll grow a watermelon in your belly? Have your parents ever told you that? Or maybe a grandpa or an uncle that's trying to get in trouble? It's not really true. You're really not going to grow a watermelon in your belly. But you can plant a seed inside of yourself. And you can plant a seed of peace inside somebody else, too. This is our sign for peace. How many of you are getting into arguments with siblings or with parents or with your children? You're getting a little anxious and antsy. This is the time where we're going to plant a seed of peace. When somebody starts an argument with you, you let it go and you plant the seed of peace. When someone takes your seat or when someone says something for the 700th time that you're tired of hearing, you plant a seed of peace and you let it go, or you say, I'm gonna try something different. I'm not going to take that truck from my brother. I'm not going to start an argument with my sister. I'm going to be the peaceful person. And maybe a watermelon's not going to grow in your belly, but a peaceful, joyful feeling is going to grow in your heart. And the people around you, they will also have peace growing in their hearts too. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you so much for planting seeds in all of us. Please help us be the peaceful people in our homes right now who are planting seeds of peace in ourselves, in our brothers and sisters, and mothers and fathers and children, so that we can grow peaceful people, which turns into a peaceful community and a peaceful world. In your name we pray, amen.
Our reading today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 28. Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he has raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that this does not include the one who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who put all things in subjection under him, so that God may be all in all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel according to John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have come to believe." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace to you from God and our Savior Jesus. Amen. In our first reading, we hear Paul arguing that how we understand the story of Jesus should have a direct impact on how we behave, and even more fundamentally, on why we act the way we do. In the verses prior to our first reading, Paul tells how God's story affects his life. In doing so, he encourages the people of Corinth to see the same in their own lives. A former youth leader that I worked with would often say, as a follower of Jesus, God's story is our story. The two cannot be separated. As I understand Paul's argument, compartmentalizing our faith makes us disingenuous and confuses the story for those who look to us as witnesses of the Christian faith. That is often what causes those outside the faith to not want any part of it. What they see is self-righteousness and hypocrisy that conflicts with the faith, hope, and love of Jesus. The statement is true: actions speak louder than words. Do we live a life of resurrection, full of peace and forgiveness, or one that is trapped in death with fear and judgment? We are taking the Easter season to look at the resurrection stories of Jesus. The Sunday after Easter, we read the resurrection story found in the extended ending of the Gospel of Mark. Jesus called us to live in confidence, heal the sick, and share the good news. Last week, in Luke's Gospel, we read about Jesus joining the two other followers, Cleopas and a friend, on the road to Emmaus. Jesus took the time to listen to their understanding of the things that had taken place. After they were finished, he shared with them the full story, from Moses and the prophets that spoke to Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Then it wasn't until they shared a meal that they truly understood that it was Jesus himself, the risen Lord, in their presence. They were so moved that they left that same evening, heading back to Jerusalem to tell the disciples that they had seen the Lord. Today, in the 2 weeks that follow, we are looking at John's Gospel of Jesus' resurrection appearances, first in the upper room, and the next 2 weeks while on the beach. What I hear in each one of these resurrection stories is a word of comfort, conviction, and a calling. Comfort. Jesus goes to the disciples who are locked away in a room, for they are afraid. The one they had followed was arrested, convicted, crucified, and died. What would become of them? Jesus goes to them, enters the locked room, and what are the first words he says to them? Peace be with you. This word of comfort to those who deserted and the one who denied, they had left Jesus alone during his darkest hour. Yet in their darkest hour, Jesus comes to them and offers peace. Jesus' appearance and words convicted them, and even more so with Thomas. He was the unfortunate one, not present when Jesus first appeared. Upon hearing the news from the others, in his disbelief, Thomas declared, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." Thus earning the infamous title, Doubting Thomas. 2 points to be made concerning Thomas's response. First, sharing the story of Jesus with another is difficult. Thomas, a disciple who walked with Jesus for what is believed to be 3 years, personally saw Jesus healing, the miracles that he did for those who followed him. But almost always, we want the same as Thomas. When I talk with people who say that they are an atheist, the conversation, if it continues, almost always leads to them sharing that they do have a desire of wanting to believe in something greater, but are unable to accept that which they cannot see. That is the last verse in today's gospel. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. It is for this reason I never shut the door on those who dismiss the story, no matter how often. Why? That is our calling. Jesus said a second time to the disciples, "Peace be with you," and then continued, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When Jesus said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Jesus is the Word made flesh. We are to be his hands and feet in this world. We are to do the things that Jesus had done for those that he had met along the way in his life. We are called to share a word of peace with those that we meet, offering forgiveness. We are called to share a word of conviction that anything that they have done or left undone, they can have forgiveness and a word of calling. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. That they can too join in sharing this peace and this love of God in Christ. Thankfully, we do not do it alone, but through the power of the Holy Spirit. Just as Jesus breathed the Holy Spirit on his disciples, we pray for that Spirit to be stirred up in those who are baptized. We are raised up to a new life and receive a spirit of wisdom and understanding, a spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in the Lord's presence. The greatest way to be a witness to Jesus Christ is to respond as the disciples did, in joy. Joy in the Lord's presence, and to share that joy with others in any way that we can. Remember, actions speak louder than words. During this time we find ourselves in, many are locked away in fear, uncertain about the future. I've repeated the story that's attributed to the theologian Martin Luther many times. I'd like to close with it again. When asked what he would do if the world was going to end tomorrow, he replied, "I'd plant a tree today." Last week, Wednesday, was the 50th anniversary of Earth Day, followed by Arbor Day that Friday. So being a witness of Jesus, we are to do likewise. Sharing this gift that God has given us, whether it be simply an acorn seed or a sapling, that gift that has been put within us to grow and to be comfort to others, a word that brings them hope for a future. And so outside the front doors of St. Luke's, you will find a box with acorns and saplings for you to take and to plant. And when people ask about this tree, you can share your story, a story of a God who gives life to this world, gives life to you, that offers comfort in his shade and seed to be planted within them. We do this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Spirit's gifts empower us.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the needs of the church and the world to God who raised Jesus to new life. Bless the church throughout the world. Guide ministers and missionaries as they proclaim the good news of your great love for the world. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Bless the soil and water. We especially pray for our farmers. Make us better stewards of the finite resources you have entrusted to us. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Bless the nations. Send a spirit of cooperation and compassion among all who make decisions that affect people's lives. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Bless the brokenhearted. Strengthen our communities and surround all people with supportive and loving groups of friends and neighbors. Risen Lord,
hear our prayer.
Bless the sick and dying. Work through hospital chaplains, doctors, nurses, and all staff to provide your peace, comfort, and hope. Risen Lord,
hear our prayer.
Bless our church. Work through our ministries in this difficult time and use us to be your hands and feet in the world. Risen Lord,
hear our prayer.
Bless the saints in light. Make us mindful of all who have passed the faith on to us and bring us all into your kingdom of life and light. Risen Lord,
hear our prayer.
Through the resurrection of your Son, O God, you destroy the power of death and remove your people's shame. By the power of the Spirit, raise us from sin and seat us at the Paschal feast, that we may rejoice in the gift of salvation Jesus has won for us. Amen.
Hello, my name is Paul Klein, and you have elected me to serve on the St. Luke's Lutheran Church Council as the president-elect. My duties include serving on the church council, serving on the executive committee, filling in for the president if necessary, and acting as a liaison between the stewardship committee and the church council. My wife, Julie, who you saw earlier, as is the worship assistant here at the service this morning, and I settled in Bloomington some 40 plus years ago when we finished up our education at the University of Minnesota Duluth. We moved to a house just about two blocks east of here. Julie and I were high school sweethearts. Julie was the daughter of a dairy farmer. She's also a dairy princess. And I was a son of a preacher man. Yes, I was a PK. And no, I was not that kind of PK. We raised our two kids here, Philip and Jana. And this church helped us raise them. They were both baptized here. They were active participants in Sunday school and the youth groups, the youth programs, the music programs, the choir trips, all of the possible events, camps, everything else. And they were confirmed here. And if it takes a village to raise a child, our two kids are perfect examples of that, because today, several years later, they're still very active in their faith communities. Our son Philip is a very key member of the worship team at King of Kings Lutheran Church in Woodbury. And you'll see our daughter Jana, along with our granddaughter Sadie, in Jubilee when we're allowed to sing together in a worship service. And then their father, husband, our son-in-law Dan, you'll often find back on the soundboard running sound on a Sunday morning. Back in high school, I was shall we say, more than a little bit of a science geek. The space race was in full force. Who was going to get to the moon first? Was it going to be the United States, or was it going to be those evil Russians? And for Christmas and my birthdays, I absolutely thoroughly enjoyed getting things like microscopes and telescopes, and my favorite of all time was this great big chemistry set. Everything science was something that I found absolutely fascinating. And one of the people I admired was a physicist by the name of, you'll probably have heard of him, Albert Einstein. And Albert Einstein had his special theory on relativity, which is summarized by this formula here, E equals mc squared. Energy equals mass times the speed of light in a vacuum squared. Now, I don't know what all of that stuff means, other than it has to do with relativity. And in today's environment, in today's world, one of the questions I've heard and that I've answered is, what am I relative today? Or is my family still relative today? Is my community, is my church still relative in this stay-at-home, shutdown, COVID-19, social isolation world that we happen to live in? Are we still relative? And especially as a church, I'd have to see the answers without any question. It's a resounding yes, we are very relative. While we cannot get together for praise and worship together live in person on a Sunday morning, worship is still happening. Hundreds have been worshiping online with our YouTube and our Facebook streaming services on a Sunday morning. Back during Lent, we had a Wednesday night Lenten service that was streamed online that dozens and dozens of people took in. Currently, on Wednesdays, there's a Bible study on the Book of Revelations that's happening. Mission work such as food collection and volunteering at VEEP is still happening. There's a barrel of half full of food right now out inside door A of the church. Support for Oasis for Youth is still happening. We are still driving for Meals on Wheels. We are still serving dinners at Loaves and Fishes. As a council, we're still meeting, albeit virtually and through the computer and the benefits of technology, but at each meeting we get together after our opening prayer. We say special prayers for every member that's listed on that e-news prayer request list. Even though the church is locked, the office is still staffed and basically open for businesses. We have the challenges in front of us, and they also put a lot of burden on our staff. Special shout out to Sean Johnson, our choir director, who's the technology genius behind putting the streaming worship services together. The amount of time and effort and work that goes into all of that is all still happening. And that leads me to my own personal special theory on relativity. I think mine's every bit as important or earth-shattering or shaking, perhaps, as my buddy Albert Einstein's. My special theory of relativity is S equals T cubed plus U. Now, what does that mean? Stewardship equals time, talent, and treasures plus U. Time times talent times treasure plus you. And the key part here is you, because without you, nothing happens. So many people think stewardship is nothing more than that weekly offering, or maybe it's that pledge commitment and that typically comes every fall. But there's so much more to it than that. It really is the multiplication of putting your time and your talents to work along with your financial resources. And you are the key. Again, without you, nothing happens. You are relative. Even though you may not be able to physically do what you were able to do before, your financial contributions are making a significant difference to countless people here in this community and around the world. Thank you for your past and present commitment to the time of time, talent, and treasure. And I cannot wait till we once again have the opportunity to worship together in person. Until then, be safe, stay well, and God bless you. Thank you.
Remember us, Lord, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.